Joining us right now from the Cato Institute, Julian Sanchez. He's a senior fellow at the Cato Institute and wrote what I thought was a very good piece in Time magazine dissecting this. But since you wrote that piece a couple of days ago, the story continues. Julian, welcome to the new Screensavers.
Thanks for having me.
Did the summary I just gave, is that fairly up to date of the situation?
Yeah, I think so. The latest disclosure, I suppose, is that there were mechanisms for trying to retrieve the data that Apple had suggested to the Bureau. That is to say, look, can you get it on a trusted Wi-Fi network, and maybe the backup to the iCloud is still active. It just hasn't been connecting, and you may be able to get something additional that way. It turned out that the county, which is to say the employer of Saeed Farouk,
and the owner of the phone,
technically the owner of the phone, had, at the behest of the FBI, changed the iCloud password, the Apple ID to access that, which is, among other things, had the effect of shutting down automatic backups. It also seems as though they may have powered down the phone at some point, which would have taken off the table a number of additional potential attacks that could be carried out without Apple's assistance. So at least in part, if it's the case that Apple is now uniquely positioned to help them retrieve data, it may be because other alternatives, that just errors in the earlier phases of the investigation closed off.
Maybe I'm giving the FBI too much credit, but I think it's pretty well known that if you have a suspect's phone, it's still turned on and unlocked, that you keep it powered up and unlocked. You put it in a Faraday bag if you need to keep it from communicating with the outside world. But there are well-known procedures for getting the data off of these phones. Mm-hmm. Yep. It sounds like the FBI did everything it could to thwart those procedures, and it leads me to think that the FBI may have been looking for an opportunity to bring this case to a court and get a precedent, because they'd like this to happen all the time.
Well, you know, I mean, so I think as to whether they sort of dropped the ball intentionally, I think I just never explain through malice what ineptitude can adequately account for.
True, true.
In most cases, that's enough. But I do think you're absolutely right that this is an instance where the Bureau is much more interested in the precedent they can set here than in the evidence that they can get on the phone. This was, again, this was his work phone that he had to know was sort of potentially subject to monitoring. It was not one of the phones that he destroyed physically prior to going on his rampage. So, you know, you understand why they want to cross all the T's and dot all the I's, but the idea that there's essential evidence on the phone is pretty dubious, whereas we know that Apple had requested, at least initially, that they file this request in private so they could sort of consider it, that is to say, under seal, in a way that would be less likely to generate a kind of binding precedent for other courts to follow. And the Bureau, I think, in a move that seems sort of deliberately tailored to antagonize Apple, chose not to file the motion under seal to compel. And I think the reason for that is that this phone is itself sort of a sideshow. There would not be really be dangerous to privacy in general if on a, you know, these sort of older phones they chose in a couple of cases to unlock. What I think really worries people is a precedent that says under the All Writs Act, this sort of catch-all legislation from 1789 that lets courts issue orders, that a technology company can be forced to write software for the FBI, investigative forensic software, effectively spyware or hacking tools, and then sign that software with their developer key. If that precedent is established, that is something in general the FBI can compel a company to do to aid in an investigation, you're opening the door not just to smartphone exploitation, but really I think undermining kind of the fundamental infrastructure of trust that we depend on when we bring phones and computers into our homes and are going to be relying on a great deal more as the sort of Internet of Things dawns. If you can get a company to write signed malware, essentially, you're talking about giving them the keys to any laptop or device that's running software with sort of root privileges that is on that machine. So then we're talking about remote activation of microphones or web cameras, if that's the easiest way to conduct surveillance on a target. your toaster, for God's sake, or your smart TV, which has voice control capabilities. And so I think looking to that was what caused Apple to be much more anxious. And also in the nearer term, just institutionally, we know there are hundreds upon hundreds of phones around the country that various police departments would love to get into. And so it's not, as the FBI, I think, rather disingenuously claimed, this sort of one-off request where they can delete whatever tools they're required to build as soon as its function in this one case is exhausted. Rather, it's obvious that lots of district attorneys, lots of police departments are going to have similar requests for their own version of this software or other similar software. And you're effectively going to have to create a kind of sub-institution within Apple, the same way that they have compliance teams dedicated full-time to deal with search warrants or requests for internal records. They're going to effectively have an internal institution dedicated to building code that aims at undermining the same security features other divisions within the company are working to harden and creating a kind of, I think, untenable situation.
This doesn't surprise me. I mean, I would expect this came directly from Director James Comey, who has been very outspoken in saying we can't do our job because so much of the communications we have been listening to have gone dark thanks to encryption. He is not speaking for the government universally. There are parts of the government, I've been told, including the NSA, who think encryption is an important part of national security and that good encryption, unbroken, unbackdoored encryption is necessary. And I also would say that, it's probable that Apple could go and argue, well, Judge, you don't really need this data from this phone. There's nothing on this phone, and maybe even win in court, but that would be kicking the can down the road. It's very clear that the battle is lining up between people like Director Comey and the FBI who want access to all information. They don't want encryption. They want backdoors to all encryption. And private industry and frankly many users who say we should have the right to privacy. But I think what's important to point out is even if the FBI won in this case, there's no way to stop encryption. The math is known.
Yeah.
The encryption is being made available now in 70 different countries. Anybody who is sophisticated enough to know about encryption, and we think ISIS is, we've seen some of the information they have, would be able to find encryption that there is no backdoor. It would only really harm U.S. companies who comply with U.S. law. On the other hand, we also know that Comey and others have said, hey, don't worry about it. We can spy on you in so many ways. The Internet of Things, as you mentioned, is going to make it so we don't really need this encrypted data because your refrigerator will be telling us what you're up to from now on. So I don't I wonder if this is really ultimately that important.
Yeah, I was actually part of a cybersecurity working group at the Berkman Center at Harvard Law School.
Did you do that Don't Panic paper? Because that was
amazing. I was on that, yeah.
Really, really good.
So it was a group of us that worked together to put out a report on the sort of supposed going dark because of encryption problem. And, we concluded, among other things, that there was such an explosion in sources of data for both intelligence and law enforcement that the loss of the sort of small subset of data that would be rendered irretrievable by encryption was not really representing a kind of net going dark problem, a net diminution of their ability to gather data. And one of the things we highlighted was the Internet of Things and the profusion of sensors we keep on our bodies and in our homes. I've got an echo over my shoulder there somewhere, probably unwise for someone who writes for the NSA as much as I do. But we had, I think, different levels of attitudes. This is a group that included some ex-intelligence folks. And so there were perhaps a range of attitudes about how much to welcome this and how much we think the law ought to encourage, certain aspects of this. But I think it is right that in general, there's lots of ways for the FBI and for the NSA to gather information that doesn't require them to break encryption. There are ways to get around that in specific cases.
And if you're a terrorist,
really large scale,
if you're a bad guy, there are plenty of ways to use encryption.
Yeah. I mean, isn't
and Bruce Schneier, who's actually one of my colleagues on this working group, also just put out a report on basically the kind of international
that's what I was quoting that's
source
right
of so much software. So there's really this is a point I've made in the past as well. You can pass whatever backdoor legislation you want tomorrow, but it's not going to uninstall the copy of Ricochet or the copy of GPG that's already sitting on my hard drive. And you can bet, you know, on ISIS's hard drive, and it's not going to pull it off the servers around the world that are already hosting it. It's just unrealistic to expect that at least sophisticated terrorists, maybe not a guy like Saeed Farouk, who doesn't actually seem to have been operating under any kind of elaborate direction from ISIS, but really sophisticated adversaries are not going to be counting on, you know, a U.S. company to provide them encryption, and even more so if it becomes clear that that company can be forced to sign code designed to countermand its own security measures.
So I think everything you just said is really exemplified by your T-shirt, which I believe is a 1984
I love that.
Book cover.
I love that.
So, I mean, isn't this?
Did you put that on purpose, Julian, or is that something you just wear?
I just have a rack and it's full of these. The other one's Brave New World. Yeah.
So I mean,
nothing but surveillance dystopia shirts.
Isn't this a perfect example of what you're saying? I mean, because they're, you know, it isn't. They destroyed their other phones. This is their work phone. There's probably nothing on it. They could have gotten it. So why is the government using this as a case where, I mean, to me, it's a good example of what we would get by what they would get by forcing Apple to create basically a new a new OS for the phone and a backdoor. What they would get is probably very little, if nothing. So I mean, isn't that a good example of what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, certainly probably very little at the margin. They've already gotten the iCloud backups from this phone up to about 6 weeks ago, at which point that was the last backup. We're not sure exactly why. And as well as, of course, metadata from the cell providers, as well as messages that he sent on Facebook that seem to have been unencrypted. It's hard to believe that this is really a fight that they're going to the mat on because they think there's something vital on this phone. Now, Apple's not going to win on that. That is to say, Apple is not going to get a judge to back off because Apple doesn't think there's something valuable there. They're going to defer to the FBI if the FBI says they think there might be. But I do think it suggests that this is much more about what an ideal case. When James Comey has talked in the past about the going dark problem, he's tried to advance a series of anecdotes about cases where encryption either did or would have stymied some important investigation, a kidnapping or something else sort of emotionally resonant. And very few of those anecdotes have held up very well under scrutiny. And so I think this is an instance where, you know, they're following the advice of the Office of the Director of National Intelligence General Counsel Bob Litt, who in a memorandum this summer made it out into the press, said, well, it looks like we've sort of lost on this going dark fight for now, but we need to keep our eyes open for a terror attack where we can kind of leverage public sentiment into mobilizing legislation. And I think what they see here is a case where if we can claim that you know, Apple encryption or full device encryption is a problem here, it'll be very difficult politically and in terms of public opinion for the companies to push back, and we can get a precedent we want, or motivate Congress to act if we lose. This is, I think, a kind of Xanatos gambit on their part, where if they win, they get the precedent they want. If they don't win, you have, you know, Donald Trump and Ted Cruz and all, you know, Rubio all denouncing Apple's resistance
which
here.
Which they have already.
Yeah, exactly. And I think you motivate an action from Congress potentially that they've thus far been unwilling to provide the FBI.
Yeah. It's interesting because Congress has asked both Comey and Cook to testify. I mean, there is a lot of congressional interest in this, but I have to wonder if the FBI this strategy might have backfired, because as much as people are clamoring for Apple to back down, I think far more people, and not just we geeks, but a lot of people who aren't necessarily technically literate, are saying Apple should stand firm. Do you think this has backfired for them?
I think they're getting more pushback than I'd expected. I think they thought that publicly filing the request might put Apple in the position of being sort of too skittish about its public face to resist very hard. But again, I think this is probably something they gamed out pretty well. Even if folks at technology companies and even a lot of the public is sympathizing with Apple. I haven't seen any actual polling data on that. And I, of course, live in a weird Twitter bubble, so I'm not sure how representative the attitudes I'm seeing expressed are. But I think if you look at what members of Congress and political actors are saying, it's much more sympathetic. They're just constitutionally much more inclined and temperamentally to find it sort of outrageous that a company is fighting a request from law enforcement. And again, they picked a case where, you know, there's not really any argument that, the FBI shouldn't get the data on this phone if they want it. It's really about the larger picture that would be the result of creating the precedent they want. But it seems like in terms of the public statements I've seen from, members of Congress, for example, that this may have had the effect, even if they, or especially perhaps if they lose in court, of mobilizing legislators who were not necessarily urgently motivated to move forward with some kind of CALEA update or other backdoor legislation to start putting stuff on the table.
Well, the good news is the geeks have been alerted, and Paul Revere yes. has run his ride. Julian Sanchez is a senior fellow at the Cato Institute, former Washington editor at Ars Technica, writer for The Economist's Democracy in America, founding editor of the Policy Blog, a good blog, too, that I highly recommend on this subject, and others, Just Security. I think it's justsecurity.org.
Yep, yes, it is. That is us.